Ladies and gentlemen, and Mr. Moderator, and Helen Caldicott, thanks to you very much for this extraordinary two-day meeting in which I've learned a great deal. I think maybe David Freeman should really be the cleanup speaker on this because he's gotten the message across. So I'm going to just... been an interesting precept that not long ago we were hearing that if living conditions didn't stop improving in this country, we were going to run out of humble beginnings for our great men. And life was said to be easier than we thought. All that we had to do was accept the impossible and do without the indispensable and bear the intolerable. So I think we can agree that life is not just one damn thing after another. It's one damn thing over and over. Kim Hubbard perhaps put it the best. The world gets better every day and then worse again by evening. Othello says it is the very era of the moon. She comes more near the earth than she was wont and makes men mad. The moon on course, a source of moonbeams and moonlight and moonshine. The moon off course, a push to moon quakes and moonscapes and madness. A wonderful metaphor for all of dual-use technology. Radiation as the prime example. It can diagnose cancer, it can treat cancer, but it also creates it. So I've been asked to talk a little bit about the BEIR7 report in terms of process and product. Is that okay? And the report came out a few years ago. I was a member of the committee for 6 years, and it was surely an interesting experience. And it represents the latest in a series begun in 1972. You've heard a lot about it these last 2 days, and rightfully so. And some of my material I'll move along fairly quickly. It was created to convey the level of risk of ionizing radiation, and it's widely accepted as a source of reasonable material. So this is really what we'll be getting to, and that was part of the purpose, really, in the sense that the Congress had mandated openness of the session. At times, things got a little confrontational as the industry groups, the activists, and the self-involved took center stage. And passions ran high because to some, the stakes seemed high. If the report affected policy, larger risk estimates and lower permissible doses might follow. With lower estimates, a relaxation of protection standards might be in the air. You all know that in 1947, the Atomic Bomb Casualty Commission was created in Hiroshima. Later it became the Radiation Effects Research Foundation, and its purpose was to document and to understand the long-term effects of exposure. The original lifespan study of 120,000 survivors and the adult health study of 25 continued over a 65-year period until today. And as you've heard time and time again, they provide powerful evidence for evaluating cancer risk from radiation. This is the building of the Radiation Effects Research Foundation in Hiroshima. It's supported by the United States and by Japan. It has 400 scientists working away on a great variety of projects. And during one of my visits there, the visit was occasioned by the sense of a congressman that we were spending money fruitlessly on this project abroad. And so an international committee was created, of which I was a member. We spent a week there looking at all of the projects, and we were able to come up with the recommendations that this was one of the great and unreproducible epidemiology studies that the planet had ever seen. And so the funding continued. The survivors were widely distributed by age. In 1995, 44,000 still survived, and by 2020, there'll still be 14,000 alive, and all of them will have been under the age of 20 when they were exposed. So this period is going to be a quite important one. So you can ask, why low-level radiation? And one of the answers is that because the harmful effects of large and medium doses have been amply demonstrated over time, we have not been able really to come up with certainty in the past about the effects of exposure at low levels. They've been more difficult to document. And part of that is that the use of the term goes all over the map. This is a chart that I created for our BIR7 committee. And in it, I have noted 19 different estimates, all of them with low-level radiation in the title of the paper and all in referee journals, with a range of a few hundred times between top and bottom, from 3,000 millisieverts down to 20 millisieverts, and all of them called low-level radiation. Well, we came up with our own definition, which was derived from a consensus of the committee and the outside reviewers, and that was levels up to 100 millisieverts, the lowest doses with relevant data that were available. I won't go into, I think you're all aware that a sievert equals 100 rem in the old terminology, 1 joule of energy per kilogram, but millisieverts, as we know, are a very common measure of radiation energy deposited in living tissue. And 100 roughly equal 10 rads or rems in the older terminology. That's about 30 to 40 times our annual background of 3 millisieverts, and it's 10 times out of a CAT scan and 1,000 times that of a chest X-ray. 65% of the atomic bomb survivors received a low dose, that is to say, at or below 100 millisieverts, as best the dose symmetry could be achieved. So most of the radiation that we're exposed to comes from our natural background, air, food, outer space, the Earth, radon gas as a major source. That comprises 82%, and this is clearly the same diagram that you saw before, whereas 18% is related to man's intervention. And of that, tap water, tobacco, building materials, and medical x-rays and nuclear medicine are the largest element. Here you see this in a pie shape, broken up. And the important note to make is that over 300 million medical x-rays are performed every year, and over 120 million dental x-rays. And the CAT scans, as you know, have been contributing a good deal of the high-dose diagnostic examinations. The average annual effective dose is 50 milligrams or 0.5 millisieverts. But some of the exposures are much higher. That is to say, a GI tract or angiography or interventional radiology, and those range up into a level of 8 millisieverts or sometimes even more. CAT scans have been used, as I said, a lot, and sometimes they've been used sequentially. And a big worry here is their use in young people when there's something that's being followed, because a cumulative dose can get quite high. When they are performed repetitively over the years, it's been calculated that they increase the cancer mortality risk by almost 1 in 50. So radioisotope exams are also very common, as well as being a source of rather large doses. You can see the cardiovascular and the brain studies, 14 millirem, 12 millirem, or 12 or 14 millisieverts in our present language. But it's got to be clear that we're all exposed. Exposure increases the risk of developing radiation cancer. As far as the mechanism is concerned, it's complicated. There's damage to DNA that's been talked about, single and double strand breaks and oxidative changes in the nucleotide bases. And then the DNA deletions and the gene and chromosome damage begin the process whereby cancers are produced. So what were the conclusions that the committee came to? And one that was crystal clear was that the linear non-threshold model of cancer risk prediction was validated by the committee. There was no evidence of a threshold below which no cellular damage occurs. And more importantly than that, significant lifetime risks were shown. We know that high radiation doses tend to kill cells, lower doses to damage the genetic code. The higher the dose, the sooner the effects of radiation will appear. As far as the model. Here you see the straight line, linear no threshold model, and it is by far the best working model that has been achieved thus far. What about the excess risk? 12 cancers, including lung, liver, breast, prostate, stomach, colon, thyroid, and leukemia. And the excess risk, if you look, for example, at breast, it's almost 100%, but for others, it's well over the 50% level. The number of excess cases of cancer from exposure to 100 millisieverts at the age of 30 and then an attained age of 60, 800 in females, these are rough figures, 1,300 in females. And this substantiates what you've heard earlier in the afternoon about the differential in production of tumors in males and females. Since our report, there have been a number of important epidemiologic studies. And the 15-country study in particular, in 2006, 446,000 nuclear workers and clear evidence of an increased level of cancer deaths at the 1 to 2% level. Elizabeth Cardis in France conducted this, but with the collaboration of many others as well. The Teka River study is an example of where a contaminated river full of the waste from the Maya nuclear production firm caused a clear increase in cancer risk, 3%. And then the UK study, that should be 175,000 nuclear workers, in which, again, protracted radiation with a higher risk. And the last one I'm going to mention is the combined post-2002 study of 12 epidemiologic studies that really confirm the basic conclusions of the BEIR-7. Now, we can look to this difference in related mortality for women, 37.5% higher than for men. Infants, as compared to adults, 3 to 4 times the cancer risk, with female infants having almost double the risk of males. There are countervailing approaches, such as hormesis, which you have heard discussed, interest in the bystander effect, adaptive responses, which we know have been documented, and genomic instability. But the one observation that there is total concurrence in is that all of the figures that are produced are subject to a certain level of uncertainty. So, low doses, and this is really in conclusion, low doses increase the risk, but it's not a very huge risk, it's a definite one. As lifetime exposure increases, the risk itself goes up. There will be one excess cancer in 100 individuals, but there will also be a large number of so-called naturally occurring cancers as well. And that's been one of the great problems with radiation epidemiology, that is to say, the difficulty of extracting the signal from the noise. While high levels of radiation exposure may increase the likelihood of heart disease or the risk of heart disease, that no impact of the low levels that we studied could be found, and we were unable to determine the presence of genetic effects in the offspring of A-bomb survivors, which is kind of in contrast to the animal studies, which showed that increased cellular mutations in animals can be passed on to their offspring. So, this was a balanced and thoughtful committee. There was a lot of expertise in a lot of different areas. There was a good bit of controversy. There was one member who clearly did not believe, at least at the outset, that low doses of radiation had any ill effects on human subjects. But the discussion kept going, and the witnesses were a major element in the ability to develop a consensus. So I started out with the moon, but I end up with a Chinese proverb, "A star, however willing, cannot help the moon, and 1,000 stars are not equal to one moon." So we never have all the answers. And I must say, one of our faculty has been so imbued with research that he sent 2 of his children to Sunday school and kept the other 2 home as controls. But he still doesn't have the answers. Thank you for your attention.